Welcome to the only Star Trek podcast that exists on the internet.
Hello.
Hi, I am Peter, one of your co-hosts.
And I am Rachel, one of your co-hosts. This is now an ASMR podcast.
It's a Billie Eilish song. I'm singing really quiet. So you gotta turn the volume up real loud. She's great. I like her songs. But I do think she sings like that. I don't feel like she has like volume, right?
Yeah, I guess it checks out. I don't listen to a lot of her stuff. Not like on purpose, but
yeah,
I just don't listen to music a lot.
So I was like, oh, we should just record because we started babbling about, you have this space background.
Mm-hmm.
And you said you're in space, and I said, we're all in space.
And I was like, whoa.
And then I heard on Slash Filmcast. Supposedly, scientists have figured out, by whatever science-y means, that if you take space and eliminate all sources of light from it, the universe itself glows.
That sounds familiar. Is that a new thing that they figured out?
I don't know. I just heard it on this week's podcast, so maybe.
Huh. Yeah.
Isn't that weird?
That is weird. Like, is it radiation? Do they know what causes it?
I didn't. It was just a little snippet. I didn't look into it, so it was like third hand information.
Oh, gotcha.
Yeah.
That's neat.
Yeah, still pretty cool. Yeah, I have some musical themes for this week's episode. Oh, I want to say we are recording on December 11th, 2020, and we are talking about season 3, episode 9, Terra Firma Part 1. I want to say that at the beginning of this recording-ish, because when I was trying to go back and do some other recordings, I was like, what episode is this? What are we talking about? So now we know. And now you, the audience, knows. And some musical, I have two musical themes for you, Rachel, that you can pick your favorite for this episode. Okay. Share computer sound. Click share. Okay. Okay, here's one. Ready? Why is there no sound happening?
I don't know.
I don't know either. Why? Refresh. How about now? Because I have no volume control on that thing. Because, spoilers, there's a part in here where Tilly and Giorgio hug, and I texted you and said...
That's going to be one of my favorite things.
Yeah. But yeah. Thematically, this song is what I would listen to in middle school to get like really amped up for running cross country.
Okay.
Really amped up. Let me not blow our eardrums off. Ready? This is it. Wait. This is... Probably, if you're a Metallica fan, this is like one of your least favorites because it's off of the Black Album, which a lot of them people hate. But this is what 12-year-old me would listen to get like fucking amped, run fucking cross country. Sad but true. He says like, I'm your hate, 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 I'm your hate. Okay, let's not play any more Metallica because Lars Ulrich will come after us and publicly shame us and probably sue us for, even though we make zero doll hairs off of this podcast.
None doll hairs.
Yeah. But you know, it's like hate, I'm your hate. Because, mm-hmm. you know, alternate universe.
Yeah.
Giorgio.
Yeah, I feel like that totally fits.
This is a Giorgio.
Giorgio totally listens to this song.
Yeah.
This is how she amps herself up.
This is how she winds down.
This is how she winds down. Yes.
Yeah, that's
with
her
like a glass of red wine because
I've just had a rough
the computer
day.
Won't replicate like goblet of her enemy's blood.
Yeah, I went this episode, Terra Firma Part One. I went from not giving a single solitary crap about what is going on with Giorgio. Remember we were talking about it before? Mm. I was just like, mm-hmm. I don't care. They're gonna do something. I don't care. I'm not gonna worry about it until they tell us. But yeah. Maybe that just speaks more to my tolerance of like worrying about things because the state of the world is so like
worrisome.
Yeah. And all of it's out of my control. Like I did my part. I voted Democratic and liberally. We live in a pretty liberal state, not like 100%, but you know, mm-hmm. like the things within my control. I can do what I can. And then it's just like, yeah. That's it. So
I get that. I was mostly curious about Georgia. I was like excited to see what they were going to do with her because I know she's got the spinoff series. So I know she's not going to die. Right. So like,
well, Black Widow is getting her own movie and she did.
Yeah.
Spoilers for Avengers Endgame.
That's true.
So, I mean, it's Star Trek.
Yeah, it's Star Trek. So, well, regardless, I knew.
Irregardless.
Fuck you.
I hate that word so much. I hate irregardless. That word. I hate that. It used to not be a word, and then fucking Webster caved and they made it a word.
Yeah.
I hate it.
It's right there with I could care less.
I could care less. Yeah.
I could care less. Oh, okay. So then I can keep going because you care some.
That means you care some. Yeah.
That's
a very intense eye roll. For that. Yeah, you were saying Giorgio,
she was gonna die. Super interested in what was coming and what they were going to do with it, and I'm not surprised by the path that they took. I'm not surprised that she ended back in the mirror universe. I do have a lot of questions about this very Doctor Who episode.
Oh, is it a Doctor Who episode? I haven't seen enough Doctor Who to know.
Well, it's just like this doorway in the middle of nowhere did not feel
that.
Very Star Trek at all. I love it.
I disagree. Yeah, because there's a long storied history of things like that happening in Star Trek. Like,
you know what, you're absolutely correct.
Yeah. Yeah, like
as soon as you said that, I can now like think of
yeah, like Q would bring them to places and it would be just like yeah.
Or like that episode where Riker, Worf, and Data get stuck in that casino based off of the novel.
Yeah, yeah. That's great. In old Star Trek, I feel like every episode had something like that happen in it, like the original series.
So do you think Carl is Q?
I don't think he is Q, but I think he's a, you know, he's
like
a form of it, maybe.
Something
or
from
just,
the Q continuum.
I don't know that it'd be cool if they tied it into that degree, But Q was rarely ever that helpful.
Yeah.
Like, he was there showing her what to do. I don't feel like, whatever it is, it will be something of, you know, it's something of that ilk.
Yeah. Or it's some temporal agent bullshit.
Yeah. 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 It's good. It's good.
What's been interesting is so much of the, like, the temporal stuff that they reference, like the temporal accords, are actually references to the Enterprise series.
Oh. Because
there's a ton of time travel stuff, and the temporal wars happen during the Enterprise series era.
In the series, I haven't seen much of an Enterprise.
I think it's worth a watch. It does some neat exploration of Vulcan history and, like, the history of the Federation, because it's super early days when they can only go, like, warp 3. And Vulcans can go warp 5, but feel like humans are too volatile to be allowed to go farther and faster.
Oh, that's right, because the Vulcans... because the Vulcans made first contact with the humans and all of that stuff. Yeah.
And so the whole premise of the series is this tiny little Enterprise going off on, it's like the first ship out. It's the first ship to get like 3.5 warp capability. Mm-hmm. And they put a Vulcan on the ship to watch, T'Pol.
Oh, that's right,
and,
T'Pol.
And she's like an observer. And she has like weird torpedo boobs.
Do you think they named T'Pol after the rock band T'Pow?
No, because it's T-P-O-L. T'Pol.
But yes, of course they did. But this song, this T'Pow song, oh my God.
I'm not familiar.
Well, first, let me tell you about 5G.
Welcome to the future of home internet. With the unprecedented performance of 5G
ultra
wideband.
But it's going to give me COVID, Peter?
And none of the baggage of the past.
It will, but, you know.
Okay, but it's worth it because it's fast.
Yeah.
Okay.
This is like prime skating rink song, Heart and Soul by T'Pow.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. Yes. I am familiar with the song.
Yeah. There's something about the chords in it that are like kind of sad. It's like that, like, new agey vibe.
Yeah.
Oh, I love it. I love it so much. And when she breaks it down, like, I love it. That high note. It's a pow. Okay.
It sounds like the kind of song that would play at the end of like a late 80s rom-com.
Yep.
It's very like, was it Working Girl with Melanie Griffith?
I haven't seen that. Or maybe I saw Han Solo. It when I was a kid. And Han Solo. It wasn't Harrison Ford.
No.
I mean, he was acting. So
he was business Han Solo.
Yeah. No, I think that's what
Han Solo doing business.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So Discovery. So Star Trek Discovery. Yeah, so in the episode too, so we got a bunch of things happening in this episode. Is this still the recap?
Yeah,
it's still the recap.
Yeah, because Michael's like, oh, Booker, I don't know. You'll have to talk to Saru about your intentions.
You gotta talk.
And he's like, shut up and let me be part of your crew.
Come on, I'll be. It's like on the original Roseanne when Darlene's boyfriend moved into the basement.
Yes.
I don't know about this. He comes from a broken home. We need a place to stay. He can help out around here. Same thing.
Book,
I bet that's
book can't. Yes, I bet whatever. That's where they got this plot from. Someone was watching an episode of Roseanne
from the 90s,
back before we all knew who or what Roseanne was.
Yeah.
Anyway.
So So it start. So I like that they start off. They start off the show with the spoiler that they told us in the ready room thing from last week. Like, mm-hmm. it's the scene. It's the very first scene. We learn what's wrong with Giorgio. Mm-hmm. Some kind of, oh yeah, like her cells want to get back to the same time and universe. And correct. Then here's this other guy.
This guy is cool with his neck ridge.
Yeah, he is cool. That's he a looks very like, good alien design.
He looks a little bit like an orc. Mm-hmm. There's something about the face.
Yeah.
And the skin.
Yeah, and that part of his body is that collar thing, like you said. Yeah.
He could keep snacks in there.
That would be unsanitary.
Yeah. That had to be real gross to clean out. You gotta like, anyway.
It'd be like come on. Let's be reasonable. That'd be like just carrying like throughout the day, you know? Like, I'm sure we could figure out places to put food.
I suppose.
But we got David Cronenberg again.
I love David Cronenberg in this. His character just makes me really happy.
Have you
not
seen
in small part
his
because
movies?
He looks. I haven't.
Do you want to watch the scene where Jeff Goldblum rips his own ear off from
I
the
really,
fly?
I really don't.
We could watch it on air, as it were. That man is disturbed, and he makes people for being in such a like wholesome. I call Star Trek Discovery like a mostly wholesome show.
Yeah.
That man is one of the most twisted individuals that has ever made movies.
Which makes his role in this really interesting. Like for anybody who knows him and like watches his movies, to see him here has to be kind of a trip and has to like wondering like, okay, so this is what they presented of him so far. Who is this guy? Who is this guy going to be?
I remember because we had HBO when I was a kid. And my dad worked and we were home a lot, home alone a lot. And I had a TV in my bedroom. And I remember watching The Fly by myself when I was like 9. Mm-hmm. Watching that. I watched Jeff Goldblum rip his own ear off. And then he like, by the end of the movie, he's like this melted like fly creature. Like,
right.
And they have to burn him up to death in a transporter thing or something.
Blech.
I think that's how it ends. Does it end with him being like essentially in a jar and just in like that melted state? And I remember having physical shakes and I could not get to sleep because I was just traumatized by it.
That would have been just too much for me.
It was too much for me. It was too much for me.
Like at that age, I was reading Nancy Drew books. I couldn't read the new ones because they were super scary.
Yeah, I mean, I was still that. I was still just reading Hardy Boys, and I'm like, oh, I like sci-fi. I don't know why. Why would I have put that on?
I don't know.
It was on HBO, and I was like, oh, poor it's baby rated Peter. R. I probably shouldn't watch this.
Ooh,
here I go.
And then it was a mistake.
It's great. Still a fond memory. but yeah, so he reveals some key information to the doctor about her phasing in and out of time or space or whatever. And then she's just throwing tantrums all over the place. Her right. being super mean to Tilly here and like throwing things at her. Is Giorgio a part of the crew or not?
Kind of. I feel like she's, I mean, technically she's still part of Section 31, right?
Yeah.
So she's technically part of Starfleet.
So, like, I feel like they should have, like, it's fine as is, and this is just me, like, being super picky or whatever, but... Mm-hmm. Like Tilly is her commanding officer. You don't do that to your commanding officer. Like whatever, you can be like, you know, like I feel like part of the leadership thing, I wish they would just show her like evolve, not just being like, oh, Tilly smart and people will follow her out of niceness, but like out of like, I feel like there's an opportunity to talk about, to weave in threads of like, how realistically would somebody handle being in that position, being friends with these people, now you're elevated, and like what would you actually have to do if this was a job, if this was right. Like you'd have to be like, I can't let this go, I can't let this go.
There should have been some ramifications
of, yeah,
like sometime in the brig or some privileges revoked or something for a while.
Yeah,
like just doing that to anybody, but especially your commanding officer, that's insubordination.
Yeah, you can't. Yeah, but I get it, like they need to move the story along,
right?
So like,
right,
that's it's fine, but it would be interesting to see Tilly, like to see Tilly
her explore. Take charge,
yeah, and just have them explore like for that character what will it be like to all of a sudden be you're these people's boss, you know, like you gotta call the shots, you gotta like handle shit, you know.
Yeah, I want there to be a scene soon of like someone messing up or someone, you know, sort of forgetting, you know, that she is the commander and that treating her like they normally treat her. Mm-hmm. And, you know, or they don't listen, like, well, it's just Tilly. And then her having to put her foot down and be like, you are not listening.
Yeah.
I gave you a direct order. If you continue this road, that's a court martial, you know, or
right.
Whatever.
Right. Yeah. Like, it would be cool to see them explore it a little bit. Like, it doesn't need to happen every episode, but just sure. Like, touch on it.
In the same
it.
Way that, like, you see Commander Riker doing commandy things all the time.
Yeah. All the time. Yeah. People listen to him. He's like, giving orders and stuff, you know, like,
mm-hmm. Or like seeking his advice, or like, you know, like those intense scenes where, you know, he's giving people an ultimatum to either like follow his commands or not.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I want Tilly to give somebody an ultimatum.
Yeah, yeah.
I'd like to see that.
It's going to be a different dynamic for sure. For their different characters, and like,
oh, totally.
Riker was like a company man who was like in that, you know, he was like cut out for it, you know, and mm-hmm. Tilly was like chosen for the job. So
Tilly leads like, in a different way. Yeah.
Yeah. And she needs to like figure it out on her own more. It's somewhat, you know,
yeah.
So yeah, anyways, I feel like that. I feel like they have something there that would be really interesting to get into.
Well, and we know the actress can pull that off, because later in this episode, when we jump to the mirror universe.
Oh yeah.
And
yeah.
We have Captain Killy again. Oh my God.
Is her name Killy in the other episode? In the
That's
other
her nickname.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Captain Killy.
So good. It's so good. But yeah, maybe they don't want to get that deep. Maybe they want to leave it a little light as far as all that stuff goes.
It could be.
Which is fine. So yeah, they're talking. Then they ask permission from Beard Guy. I don't know.
Which I'm glad they did.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because like, they can't just keep, you know, running off and doing stuff. And I appreciate what Beard Guy says. I need to learn these people's names about this. Because for a while it was like, you have like the whole of this sector to worry about. And you're worried about this one person, like a big part of what they do is run around and like help all these different people. And we've seen them help like small groups of people before, but this is one person. But then Beard Guy makes such a good point about, if you let this one person drown, the rest of your crew won't look at you the same, and you won't look at yourself the same. And sort of just as a matter of upholding Federation principles all the time would dictate that they need to save Giorgio.
Mm-hmm.
I also enjoy the part that's on the screen right now where I don't remember anybody's name right now, but Glasses Man is like, she's gonna kill everybody she finds if you don't find a cure for her.
Yeah. Yeah. You should lock her in the brig until, because she's gonna fight and find a way. Yeah.
And not just like kill people, but destroy civilizations. Because that's what Terrans do when they're sick.
They're sort of like the Klingons of this series. Like they just took all of the traits of the Klingons and put them into the Terrans.
You're referring to Commander Arian. Your entire crew would have died.
Yeah. Again, then they bring up about Arian and.
Oh, I missed that part when I first watched it.
Yeah. On the ready room for this episode, they talk to all the bridge crew. It's worth watching because I think it will make you appreciate each one of their characters more.
Okay.
That kind of stinks that you have to go like outside of the show itself to get more insight into characters, but I liked it just because I'm like, ah, yeah, like I want to hang out with these people. Like, yeah. And the actress who plays Arian is on there, and she talks about like makeup and like not having makeup and like coming back after 10 episodes. It's pretty good.
Also, real quick, I've been listening to the Star Trek logs on Instagram.
Oh yeah, those are good.
And I really appreciate those, especially the ones that don't directly address plot points or like address like minor plot points, like Linus talking about how he was so happy that he was finally back in Georgiou's good graces.
Oh.
Because he'd shed on her rather publicly by accident. He shed some skin. And then she accepted his gift of popcorn. I love you. I love it so much.
Yeah, it's good.
I love Linus.
Yeah, he's a very good addition. I feel like the first two seasons they were like trying to figure out what this show should be, and I feel like this season they've finally figured it out.
Yes.
They got like the right mix. They got like the right mix of like kind of here's like a little standalone episode, here's like a broader thing. Yeah, I feel like maybe not 100% figured it out, but they're getting there for sure.
Yes.
I hope this goes on for, I feel like we need 6 or 7 seasons of this show, honestly.
That would be terrific.
Yeah.
It should have at least as many seasons as the other series have had.
Yeah. TNG was 7. Original series was what? Only five, right?
Yeah. Because it was a 4-year mission.
I think it was a five-year mission. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I don't know about, I think DS9 was on for, if only there was a way that we could know this. If only there was some sort of device that could tell us how many seasons.
I think that was 7 seasons.
Seasons there were. Yeah, 7. 7. What about Voyager? Voyager Star. Hello, computer. Tell me how many Star Trek Voyager seasons there were. 7. Right? Yeah.
Yes. And Enterprise was like 4 seasons. Because they canceled it partway through the 4th season.
Oh, did they? Did they wrap it up at all? Or
kind of. It's very fast.
Yeah.
And I was maybe wrong about the temporal wars. I thought that was, so the temporal wars are part of Enterprise, but in this episode, Glasses Guy references, you're lucky you missed the temporal wars.
Mm-hmm.
So there must have been more that happened sometime in those 900 years.
Yeah. Yeah. I want to get to. Oh, go ahead.
In Enterprise, it's the temporal Cold War.
Oh,
which is different from the temporal war.
The Cold War, the good old days of the Cold War. I kind of miss those when, like, you know, we didn't have when we had an outside enemy and not like. I feel like we weren't. You know, trying to argue about legally electing people and dismantling like what a democracy is based on.
Right. I mean, that's true.
In other ways, we are way better off. Don't get me wrong. Oh yeah, the chain, the emerald chain. Come on. I saw the worst take from somebody on Facebook. I saw the absolute worst take.
What did they say?
I'm sick of these Star Trek Discovery episodes teasing a big space battle with the chain, and then they like just go off and do something different. It's like no. If anything, you got it like the exact backwards. Like, ditch the chain. It's all this other stuff that's the good stuff.
Yeah, like the chain is a way of adding. It's like a generic way of adding tension. Yeah. Like, well, we have to do all these other things, but also the chain.
Yeah, don't forget. But
also, don't forget about the chain.
Yeah, and what would the pay? What's the payoff going to be? Like, yeah, they're going to have a big space battle.
Do you think?
That's not that interesting.
I feel like the most Star Trek thing would be for Michael to negotiate some sort of peace with the chain and like get them on board and like
yes,
get them to like join the Federation.
Yeah. Yeah,
like at least appeal to the like Andorians who are one of the founding members of the Federation.
Yeah, like it's going to be revealed that, you know, the Andorians were long lost ancestors of the green face guys, and like actually they have a book that that's going to be the Star Trek thing. So clearly that's why it was the worst take. Like, this person is like, are you I don't know what
I hope they don't have some big, like, I don't mind some big space battles, but to me, that's not what makes Star Trek interesting.
No, and I think one of the reasons that we're going to be spared of that is they don't have that much money. like CG, like if we're talking episode long space battles, that costs money, and I don't think the producers of the show have that much to do that.
Right.
So we are not going to get that. Like that one scene of what is her name? The pilot. I always forget her name.
Detmer. Kayla Detmer.
That was great. And it was like a minute.
Oh, that was so cool.
That was great. It was just like a little frosting. Just like here's the cupcake. Just get like a little frosting. That's all you need. Get on with the good stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Too much and it would just been, yeah. So this is like the classic, this is what I call the pro wrestling scene, where you have to come up with a reason for the good guys to fight each other.
Yeah.
And you know, it happens in comic books too, but you always got to have a reason. Why is Batman fighting Superman? They're both on the same side. How do we make this happen? Let's conjure up some reason. We gotta have.
Because JoJo's sick and she wants an honorable death.
Yeah. And this is also a Worf scene. This is like Worf.
100%.
Yeah.
Like, that I could. Slap. I mean, Worf probably wouldn't have slapped anybody.
No.
He maybe would have punched someone. Killing me. Like, yeah. I could see this like panning out between Worf and Riker.
It would have been my greatest honor to have been killed by
you. Yeah.
I'm sorry to disappoint.
Because they were, I think Worf and Riker were like close enough.
Well, they were after the same lady for a little while.
Mm-hmm. And sometimes they did those like that like fighty calisthenics program that Worf did. Do that together.
Yeah. You want honor? Why I really want some time in Discovery for them to do the classic Star Trek
two-headed punch.
Yeah. The like axe chop, which doesn't really look like very effective at all, but is very Star Trek-y.
And then I need them within the same scene to roll, to do like a somersault.
Oh yeah, a combat roll. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
A combat roll. I need a combat roll and a two-handed punch. I feel like I've seen the two-handed punch at some point in Disco.
So does that mean you're coming? is this part interesting to you? It's not that interesting to me.
It's not that interesting to me. It was like the scene where they're fighting is just leading up to, like, of course they're gonna go to this planet.
Yeah.
And it's fine. That's alarm clock.
Dr. Colbert wants you to wear it. So, and she's supposed to wear this bracelet thing that turns a certain color. And then we get, and 11 minutes in, we got the intro. Hasn't happened in previous episodes. Normally it's sooner. Skip forward, computer.
Forward. So they go to the planet.
Well, wait, before they go to the planet, here's your scene coming up.
I do love this scene where they say goodbye to folks.
Yeah, good start. It's all, I mean, Star Trek is always about saying, it's like,
it's about the people.
I am your friend.
And their relationships, yeah.
You are my friend. We are, you are my friend. It's like a different version of it.
I have learned as much as I learned from our prime, Giorgio.
Where I'm from, we were prime, and you were the mirror.
Oh, that was pretty deep.
Good luck, Emperor.
Thank you, Captain.
Here it is. Here's your favorite. Here's my favorite part, I guess. I'm calling it your favorite part. I don't know if it is.
Well, Annie and I watched this together today, and we did talk about this scene. About, like...
And Tilly is hugging
Giorgio. Giorgio is, like, super into the hug.
Must not show emotion.
Like, for... what we kept thinking is, like, oh, man, Tilly's real soft. I keep hugging Tilly. And then we realized probably most people have that reaction to hugging Tilly. She just looks real huggable.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, and they get to the planet, and then...
Gotta, like, walkaways, and then they find a guy with the door.
Yeah, they find the guy with the door. Adira and Stamets are doing their thing. Adira's too hard on themselves about... Well, before they find the guy with the door, Adira's too hard on themselves about being tired and, like
missing something with, like, the algorithm.
They need sleep. Stamets says, you need sleep. Of course you're going to miss something when you're treating yourself like that. Be nice to yourself. And then here's Book saying, can I move in?
Firm's intelligence we've already received. Who are your sources?
Curious. Can't say who, but it does confirm your own intel.
So he's like, I can help you.
I know folks that know things.
I know people. I'll do chores around here.
Laundry.
I'll be a good roommate. I'll be a good roommate. Is what I'm saying. And Saru's basically like, we'll see.
Let's read the field manual.
Yeah, he tells him to read the field manual. That's a good way to. He's not exactly telling him to fuck off, but that's a good way to tell somebody to fuck off.
Yeah. He's literally telling him to read the fucking manual.
Go read the manual. Yeah, and then they get to the door.
There's this guy in a bowler hat and a newspaper.
I love it.
In a Rondak chair.
I was just reading about you. Emperor Giorgio dies horribly
painful death, says the newspaper.
Jeez. What was the newspaper called? The Star Dispatch.
You read all about it, huh?
What the hell is this?
This is obviously this.
Who are you? And what are you doing?
Does he have a name?
Carl.
I'm Carl.
I feel like Carl has to stand for something. Like, Carl's an acronym.
Maybe.
Just the way he said it, or he doesn't actually, like,
yeah,
whatever he is.
It's just such a generic name. Like, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and then there's, like, I really love stuff like this where it's like, what is this? It's a door. Here's a little riddle. It's like,
and all of this is based on, like, trusting the sphere, and that the sphere is, like, actually helpful. That was also a great scene where, he's talking to Hugh and Glasses Guy are talking, and Glasses Guy's like, there's no possible cure. There's no possible way to find anything else. And he was like, computer, put these two things together and do another research. And that's guy, there's nothing. And, and then the computer, it's like, we have found one solution.
Right. Yeah. 5% chance of success.
Right.
Yeah. It's cool that they, it's a neat device to have. Like they needed something to make Discovery stand out even 900 years in the future, and having right. that sphere thing be in the ship is a good plot device to make it unique.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm gonna confess something ahead of time. Mm-hmm. I like the stuff in the alternate universe thing,
mm-hmm.
but I don't feel like there's like much to sink my teeth into. It's kind of just fun to watch.
Yeah. I love the Mirror Universe stuff. I think it does a good job of highlighting how Georgiou has actually grown and changed while yeah. she's been in Prime Universe. So it's a good thing for that. But I think for the most part, it's just fun.
Yeah.
It's just some fun because like Killy, seeing like sweet Tilly dressed like that and like acting like just such a stone cold bitch is,
yeah,
and everybody is just
her hair's straight
chewing the scenery,
yeah,
and, like
they're fighting each other to the death.
Fighting, yeah. And all the like gold armor and dark eyeliner, and then have you seen the episodes in Deep Space Nine where they're in the Mirror Universe?
No.
Because if you go back and if you go and watch those, Michael Burnham is very heavily pulling inspiration from the Kira Nerys character's Mirror Universe counterpart.
Oh, actually, that does ring a bell. That does ring a bell, actually.
Where it's just like leather clad lesbian.
Yeah.
Everybody is bisexual in this Mirror Universe. And
and fucking like, mean.
So mean. Just yeah. mean and will fuck everybody. and fuck them over.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, and she's trying to figure it out. So she went back in time. Like, she's trying to figure out when Burnham tried to kill her. And, you know, there's a plot against her. And they're fighting. And, you know, the two bridge people are fighting. She's talking to Burnham a bit. And then they show that... What's Saru's race?
Kelpians.
Kelpians, yeah. That they're still enslaved there. But then she uses the Kelpian knowledge against Burnham later on. Because she was talking to the Kelpian, to Saru, about, you know, knowledge that he has. Yeah, that's where the fight happens after that.
Also, I really, really love her like starburst headpiece. And yeah. then this
did you notice have you seen the Flash Gordon from the 80s?
I don't think so.
Oh, it real, real good. And like, very good, very like kind of cheesy, like mm-hmm. Queen does all the music in it. So it's got like great music.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah. Queen, the theme song for Flash Gordon is a Queen song, and it's amazing.
Like I've seen like old, like the original Flash Gordon. I've seen some of those, but
I've never seen those. I've just seen this. But like the bad guy, it's like yeah. the Mirror Universe is very much based off of
yes. It's very classic
yeah.
sci-fi villain.
Yeah. What is that guy's name? I forget his name. Yeah. Yeah. And like, check these guys out, these Hawkman guys. We should watch this movie. I would love to watch this movie again with somebody who's never seen it. Look at Timothy Dalton in this movie.
Is it Ming the Merciless?
Ming the Merciless. That's right. Look at Timothy Dalton.
Whoa.
I know.
It's like baby Dalton.
Hottie Dalton. Yeah. And this guy was some ex-football player who this is the only movie he was ever in.
Is that Flash Gordon?
Yeah, that's Flash Gordon. And I think he was literally an ex-football player. Like in Flash Gordon, in the movie, he's an ex-football player. Sure. And I think he was in the show. Anyway.
But yes, it's a very similar aesthetic.
We should definitely watch that. That would be so much fun. It's so goofy.
I did really enjoy like the very old Flash Gordon, which was also cheesy, but just in part because like they were working with very, very low budget special effects. And
wait, so we're gonna stay on this Flash Gordon thing for just one second, because the theme song for Flash Gordon is chemically designed to give everybody chills.
Okay.
It's like they diluted. Queen was at the top of their
Welcome
game.
Welcome to the future of
this.
Home internet.
Oh,
with the
thank
unprecedented
you.
Performance of 5G Ultra
give me
wideband.
COVID? Okay. It's so good. It's so good. Savior of the universe.
Oh my god. This is amazing.
You've never heard this?
I haven't.
Brian May's guitar.
It definitely sounds like Queen, too.
Oh, there's... Like... Yeah. And then I'm skipping ahead a little bit. Okay, we're gonna be sued if I play anymore. All right.
Oh yeah. Man, that made me really happy.
Well, after the show, we'll watch the whole thing.
Okay.
It's like, and there's Queen music in that whole movie.
Spectacular.
It's so good. Okay. And similarly spectacular is what you were just about to talk about.
Yeah, they have this like performance. I don't even know what to call it. It's like a play, but it's very like her enemies were bowed from rue. It feels very like a Greek tragedy performance or something.
Yeah, people on ribbons fluttering down, and it's, you could picture something like this happening in TNG, only like at a much cheesier level and like with less camera shots and just like a stage and like a 12-foot high, you know, sound.
Yeah.
Like just like happening, you know.
Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. I'm very glad it's so bad, I think, on one level, like Stamets saying all that stuff doesn't make any sense, but it's so Star Trek-y, I think.
Well, it's very Star Trek-y, and it's very, I can't put my finger on it. There's a quality that I've seen before. I feel like I need to look into like what inspired this scene, because also like Stamets is saying all these things about like peace and love.
Oh,
and like,
yeah.
Clearly, that is not what their society is built on.
No.
And,
yeah, it's very Shakespearean. It's like they all got together to try and kill her, and were like, "Oh, we'll seduce the queen. She's been soft, so of course she's gonna want to know about peace and love now."
Well, and there's also it.
Burnham's pissed. Evil Burnham.
It's also, it reminds me a little of, I mean, I know very little about Kabuki, but there's something about it that reminds me of like Kabuki theater, where it's like dance and drama, and it's lights and shadows. It's not like a straightforward mm-hmm. reenactment type play.
Yeah, for sure.
There's some Asian theater inspiration here, I think.
In spritz.
Yeah, I liked it. I liked it very much. Regina Andor. And like, it didn't make any sense to me that it was Stamets doing it. Like the engineer, like what is... Welcome,
Giorgio. So no.
Oh, and all of her... And like the rhyming.
The rhyming.
And then like my favorite part of this is when she stands in front of the ship that you can see in the distance.
Yeah.
Like the bright engine. And that like star fills her headpiece. Yeah, just like...
It was real good.
This outfit is what makes me look forward to attending sci-fi conventions at some point in the future again. Is because I want to see people making this, you know, like doing their versions of Giorgio.
And Evil Tilly cosplay.
Oh man.
Yeah.
Steve Hill, everybody.
Yeah. And then Stamets comes in for the kill, but she kills Stamets. Which I was kind of surprised about, because it feel like they were leaning into the fact that she's like changed and stuff, you know. So
I mean,
she won't kill Burnham, but she's like, she doesn't like Stamets. Yeah, who cares?
I mean, he was about to kill her too. So there's
but Burnham's trying to kill her.
Yeah, true. And it made me wonder. It's what made me start thinking about, like, is this scene or is this time in the mirror universe like a thing where they go and like sort of a like Philippa Giorgio, here is your life.
I think it's something. I
like
don't think it's
like a simulation.
I think it's something like that. I don't think it's actual. I don't think it's actual time travel.
Okay.
That's what I think, but I could be wrong. Yeah. But I'm with you. Yeah. I feel like it's going to be like, yeah, like I'm replaying something in my brain to fix it, you know, to fix my my dislocation or whatever they call it.
Cellular structure. Yeah.
And then there's the big showdown. Who are you? She's like, who are you? What's going on? Kill me, kill me, kill me, kill me. Lorca. Who
Lorca
I forgot about,
sees
honestly.
Me for me, right?
I was like, who's that? I got him confused with the bald guy.
Oh, yeah, the guy that was taken over by Control.
Yeah. It's like, oh, yeah, Lorca was from that.
Yeah, he was the captain on season one after Giorgio.
And she doesn't kill Burnham.
She doesn't kill Burnham. Oh. Sends her to the agonizer instead.
The agonizer, which, you know, if you're Terran, you might be into that. It might be like a reward.
Well, yeah, because there's that scene where they're at the party or whatever, and there's some people at the table who are just like holding some sort of like electrocution thing, and they're like, ah! It's the scene who can like hold out the longest.
Are you familiar with the character of Bizarro on Superman?
No, not really.
Bizarro Superman was inverse Superman.
Sure.
So, I don't know. It's just, with the Seinfeld references, they're talking about it on Seinfeld. And Jerry's like, yeah, Bizarro Superman, he would say goodbye when he first met you and say hello when he, you know, when he's leaving. And then Elaine goes, wouldn't he say bad bye? So yeah, maybe the agonizer. Maybe they'd like it.
I mean, some of them probably do.
Some of them do. Yeah. I don't know. What more to be said about this one?
Well, there's one more very important thing. We have found the source of the burn. And it was a Kelpian ship.
Oh, I was washing dishes or something at that point. That was when they're here, right? It was the cutaway back on.
I think so. Back to Discovery.
Come on.
Might be towards the end. Might be towards the very end, actually.
That makes sense.
You may proceed.
Oh, maybe
no.
Not.
It happened.
Mother of the Fatherland, Overlord of Vulcan. Woken, Dominus of Kronos, Regina Andor, Emperor Philippa Giorgio Augustus Iasmodius Centaur.
Like she starts to get like out of breath saying all of her names.
I know. Where was it? There's that thing. I thought it was right there, right?
Yeah, there it is. Yep. So
I'm glad you told me that because I was not paying attention during this part.
Sure. So it's a Kelpian, and someone in the room notices some burns on her forehead and is assuming that it's some like radiation. The ship has been broadcasting its distress signal for 100 years. And they were sent to that nebula to investigate some like new sources of dilithium.
Oh.
Those marks on her forehead must be radiation burns. It is urgent.
But it's not, huh? Interesting. So we know it was a Kelpian ship.
Yes. Which I was surprised by.
Yeah.
Like I hadn't expected that, but I am good with that. Like to me that feels relevant enough to like.
Yeah. Yeah.
Be included.
Yeah, for sure. I'm glad it seems like you said, yeah, it's more connected. It's not like something out of nowhere.
It's not just like some ship.
Yeah. So I was checking to see how many episodes are in this season. We got 13. So still a couple to go. Why'd you make that face?
I don't know. I don't know.
You made like oh God. Terra Firma's part 2 is going to be the next one. Mm-hmm. We know the rest of the names. The Citadel, The Good of the People, and Outside.
Gonna have Jonathan Frakes do another one. Do 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 do.
Olatunde Osunsanmi has directed a bunch this season.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and Frakes is in a bunch too. This was a good episode. It was good.
I really liked it. I really, really liked it.
The past few, Sanctuary was good.
Mm-hmm. Oh, speaking of Sanctuary, I may have told you this. I found out that the actor that plays Rin is married to the actor that plays Tilly.
Yeah, you told me that. Rin is the Andorian who had his antenna chopped off.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, that's cool. Nepotism, though.
Jeez, yeah,
give us all a chance.
He does a really good job, though. Right, if only they hadn't been married, you could have had that role, Peter.
I know, it would have been right in there.
He posted
I've already
some
chopped
really
my antlers off. Antenna. Whatever.
In preparation for the role.
Yeah, that's why. Clearly, they're not there.
I mean, I don't see
not
them.
Not lying. Yeah.
Some dedication. That's some method acting right there.
Yeah. All right. Any other thoughts? Any other thoughts?
Not that I can think of. I'm glad we are a little bit closer to figuring out like what caused the burn.
Mm-hmm.
I'm hoping
we will. Go ahead.
I'm hoping we get there soon.
We will get there by episode 13. That will be the big reveal.
Okay.
That's my expectation. Right?
I hope so. I would be kind of pissed if they leave it for like the next season.
It might be the cliffhanger. The chain isn't going to be the big thing.
Oh, I hope not.
Yeah, I hope not either. It's not that interesting. The burn is interesting.
The burn is very interesting.
Yeah.
And if it's related to the Kelpians, I'm very curious of like they've been around this like if I'm wondering if there's anybody left on that ship.
Oh yeah.
Because of how the Kelpians like evolve and stuff, if there's going to be some like real cool super evolved Kelpians there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, after 100 years, they've been stuck.
I have a question for you.
Yeah.
Should we pause so that I can use the restroom?
Yes.
Okay. Let's pause and we'll be right back.
Okay.
You listeners will experience no lapse in time. It will be as if we went...
As if you walked through a door.
A door, which is to be walked through. Yes. Hold on. The burn. We're back.
And we're back.
Yeah. So the burn or the chain. I'm with you. I hope the burn is the culminating
like thing. The only way I want the chain to be part of it is if they were somehow involved in the burn.
Oh yeah.
You know, yeah. That'd be mm-hmm. fine. But I think it's going to be Kelpian related, maybe, or something, or that it's like part of some dilithium life cycle that they weren't aware of, where because they're investigating this like new growth of dilithium, because dilithium resources were already starting to run out, right? And so my thoughts are they went by, they did something to this baby dilithium, and it like set off a chain reaction to destroy the rest of the dilithium.
Mm-hmm. Here, just looking at the layout of the next episodes, right? Mm-hmm. Next episode is part two of Terra Firma. So they're going to mm-hmm. talk about some Giorgio stuff. Probably mm-hmm. have some other stuff happening on back on actual Discovery.
Mm-hmm.
Probably they'll be like, oh, the chain this. Oh, the burn that, right? Mm-hmm. And then here's what I think. Then there's three episodes. One is okay. about the chain, one is about the burn, the last one is about the chain and the burn.
Yes.
And then probably leads to like some sort of culminating thing, gives us a little cliffhanger.
Yes.
So
I agree with that.
The if you don't want to hear these names, don't listen to this part, but the names of the episodes are out there. I don't know what they're about, so it's not like these are spoiling anything.
Right.
The Citadel sounds like a chain episode. The Good of the People sounds like a burn episode. Outside, that's my knowing nothing and just being like, if we're going to plot this thing out, what would make sense? That mm-hmm. that's my stab in the dark.
Also, I really need there to be some more Jet Reno coming up.
Yeah.
I miss Jet Reno. I was listening to Jet Reno's personal log about yeah. like it's cool with the holodecks, but is kind of freaked out by programmable matter. Like she can't fix that with duct tape, so she doesn't really know what to do
yeah.
with it.
Yeah.
I thought that was really excellent. But oh, and that she'd pretty happy hanging out in Risa on the holodeck with nobody except right. maybe the cat. Like she could handle the cat.
Yeah, of course she likes the cat. Yeah,
of course.
It's interesting how they break the cast and characters down on the Wikipedia page.
Mm-hmm.
They have these main people,
mm-hmm.
which I guess makes sense. Who's Nan?
She was the security officer that stayed back on the seed ship.
Oh, that's weird that they list the Nan in the main section. Saru, Stamets, Tilly, Booker, Culber, Nan. See, I would throw Adira in there.
I guess Adira hasn't maybe been in enough yet. I don't know.
Yeah. And then recurring, they list Adita? Who's that?
I think that's Beard Guy, I think.
Oh, is it?
Or is that the... No, okay.
That was the... yeah,
this is
Wikipedia. He's not recurring. Yeah, they're way off.
Yeah. Who's Kenneth Mitchell? Oh, Oded Fair is Admiral Charles Manson.
Kenneth Mitchell, get a better Wikipedia page.
He's like an actor. Okay.
All right. Well, I think.
Those
what do
good
you think?
Star Trek.
Did we wrap it up? Should we wrap it up?
I think so.
That was a good was good. It was a good Discovery episode, and it was a good podcast episode.
Yes and yes.
Right? So, until next time, we'll talk to you later. Bye-bye.
Bye.